Hello friends, welcome to this next video of Mineral Exploration Academy. Today we'll be learning about uranium exploration. Our teacher today is Mr. Pramod Kumar. Mr. Pramod Kumar has spent 37 years exploring all around India, mostly in uranium and rare earth minerals. He retired as the additional director of the Directorate of Atomic Minerals Research and Exploration, the AMD, and has worked all around the country in different types of uranium depositional environments. He has a few uranium discoveries under his belt. Today we'll be able to learn what are the principles of uranium mineralization, how uranium forms in the crust, how uranium migrates, how uranium gets trapped, what are the best locations to look for uranium mineralizations, and what are the field techniques that we use for uranium, for exploring for uranium. Welcome, Pramodji.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so today we are going to discuss about the techniques of uranium exploration. Uranium, whose atomic number is 92 and its atomic mass, as we can see, is 238 nearly. And its special property is that it is a radioactive mineral. Means it emits radiation of alpha, beta and gamma. And this is one of the qualities which we utilize in searching for the uranium and all atomic minerals. The common isotopes are uranium-238 and 235, though there are two more isotopes, but their half-life is very low, so they do not exist much. The density is very high. If we take the total Earth's crust, concentration is nearly 2 to 4 ppm, and in seawater also 3 ppb concentration is available. So it is found in nature as a uranium mineral, and it is, of course, used as a nuclear reactor fuel and for power generation. Now, as we know that uranium is found in the minerals in various forms, like uranium oxide, that is commonly called as a uraninite, or it can be in the silicates, like uranophane and coffeenite, or it can be in the carbonate form, it can be phosphates, it can be vanadates. So all these minerals, they are formed in the nature. So primary minerals are the uranium oxide and uranium silicates, while phosphates, vanadates and carbonates, they are called the secondary minerals. Now if you see the earth crust, we can see that the uranium occurs in minute concentration right from core, mantle and the crust. So what we see on the crust is the uranium that has traveled by some geological processes and has come to the crust in all types of rocks. So we can say that uranium is a ubiquitous mineral which is found actually in all the rocks, but because of its geochemistry, its secondary enrichment, that gives us a deposit of uranium. So uranium has this two uranium-4, which is a tetravalent uranium. Mostly it is insoluble. When it comes in the soluble form after reactions with water, it becomes uranium hexa, and then it becomes a soluble. So when it is oxidized from uranium-4 to uranium-6, it becomes mobile. And when it becomes mobile, it travels in the rock formations, in the joint planes, in the weak planes, and anywhere when it founds a reducing environment, it gets reduced to again uranium-4. Again, it becomes insoluble, and that is how its the concentration is formed in the nature. This is another important time-bound character of uranium. If you see that in the rocks of Archean age, we do not find any uranium. But over and above this, around this 2,800 million years time, the oldest rock for uranium mineralization is quartz pebble conglomerate. So this is an unconformity type of thing. So in Witwatersrand of South Africa, in Brazil, we have some conglomerates which are quartz pebble conglomerate. So in these conglomerates, along with gold, we get the first occurrence as a deposit for uranium. After that, nearly this 2200, which is a Proterozoic period, we get this middle Proterozoic This is another important boundary for uranium mineralization. And recently, in the last two decades, very high-grade deposits in Canada and Australia have been found in the mid-proterozoic unconformity type of deposit. Thereafter, we get this vein type of deposits around 1400, 1200 million years age. Like in India, in Singhbhum, we have this vein type mineralization, which is of this age. Now, younger to that, we may get in phosphorites and the black shales. And then we have a very vast horizon world over in the sandstone, which is about Cretaceous age, we can say. So, world over in Kazakhstan, in USA, in Canada, and of course in India, we get this sandstone type of deposits. And a very rare and the youngest occurrence we get in the calcarete type, which is young. Though in India, we do not have this calcarete type of deposit, though we have the occurrences, but in Australia, we have calcarete type of deposit. So they are the youngest. So right from QPC to calcarete, this is the time domain of the uranium deposits. This is very important for uranium exploration. Now, as we see that how do we go about the search for uranium, and it is very unique. As I told that uranium is a radioactive mineral, that means the emanation of alpha, beta, and gamma rays, and we take advantage of this property of uranium in airborne surveys, ground surveys, and radiometric surveys. So the mobility of uranium is also unique, as I have already discussed in the geochemical environment. It is used in various geochemical surveys. Now here we can see that in the igneous metamorphic or sedimentary rocks, the uranium may be present in the tetravalent state, in the lithosphere. From here, due to some chemical process, it moves in the solution. And either by mechanical process, it may go to placers or marine sediments or non-marine sediments, or this solution, the uranium plus six solution, may get reduced and again forms uranium plus four, and it may get deposited in any of the rocks. So this hydrotherms carrying the uranium six, they get deposited upon finding a reducing environment. So this is in general the geochemistry of uranium, and this forms the exogenous uranium cycle. Now, as far as the exploration is concerned, these are the just the stages of uranium exploration. This is just like any other exploration for any metal. So first stage is the finding of the anomalies, that is some concentration which is above the background. And this may be done in the first stage either by airborne survey or ground radiometric survey. So airborne survey also gives clues as to where is the possible anomaly in the ground, but that anomaly has to be ground checked. So again, we go to the ground, check that anomaly, where it is, and with the handheld scintillometer counters, again, we check the anomalies. So this is the anomaly hunting stage. Thereafter comes the prospect stage. That is once we have located an area which gives some hint that the uranium cluster of anomalies is there and possibility of finding the uranium is there, so that becomes our prospect. So all that geological mapping, geological survey, trenching, pitting, sampling, that is the stage in the prospect. And if there are some encouraging results, then we go for exploratory drilling. After exploratory drilling, either we may abandon the area if the size of the deposit and the grade of deposit is not prospecting, or we may come to evaluation stage, means more close space drilling and the total evaluation of the ore resources available. Depending on that results, we may get a deposit and then prepare a feasibility report. So this is in general the sequence of exploration. Here I have shown the time and money. Means from one stage, when you move to the other stage, the time taken, the time increases, and the cost also increases. some of the techniques that we employ in the airborne geophysical surveys, TEM methods, magnetic methods, and gamma ray spectrometry. These are the images that we get, and we get some diagrams of ternary nature in which we can discriminate between uranium, thorium, or potassium. Potassium also is a radioactive mineral. Now, this is a heliborne survey that is normally done. So this is a, and this is tied to a helicopter. Helicopter is fitted with the instruments which detect the radiation. And ground survey, on the ground, we locate some anomalies, and it is followed by ground geophysics, then followed by conventional geophysics like gravity, magnetic, or radiometric surveys. Now, these are the diagrams that we generate from them, the data which is accrued. And here we can see that minute, which are the uraniferous, thoriferous, or potassium-bearing anomalies. Now, the geological methods are same as for any other prospecting. We go to the ground, make the geological maps here, and then using our normal Brinton compass and the photographs. Now, this geological radiometric survey, this is that counter which we use for uranium exploration. It detects the gamma radiation from the ground if it is available. If uranium is there, you will get deflection in the scintillometer counter. And conventional methods of geological mapping and surveys and the camp establishment all are similar to prospecting of any other mineral, metallic mineral or so. Now, in uranium exploration, we also take recourse of the geochemical surveys. That is, we collect soil samples. We also collect water samples and steam sediment samples, because uranium is very mobile. So once we see that uranium is in the soil or in the water or in the steam sediments, see, we can locate where is the source of this uranium. It may be immediately beneath or it may be away. So this is how we trace the anomaly of the uranium and find where is the source. Now, this is a diagram that shows that this is a water table and the groundwater is flowing, and there may be an ore body from where this uranium is leached and it penetrates into the groundwater, or it comes in the soil, and this soil and the groundwater is tested, and then some indications are collected, and then wherever we see some possible anomaly, we drill it. So this is just a sequence of exploration. Now, while we carry it out the drilling, we establish a camp. This is the picture of a camp in Meghalaya. This is the drilling being done. There are many types of drilling. So we employ all those drillings. And in the boreholes, we do this gamma ray probe locking. When this probe is lowered in the borehole, and it detects the radiation, so again, the gamma ray, and through the cable, this radiations, they give deflection in the counter, and also some hint of the grade of the deposit, possible grade of the deposit. So this is their technique for knowing the grade and presence of uranium. Now, these are the core that we get after drilling. And this core is again examined both lithologically and also with the handheld counter. And this core in case of uranium is also tested in an assembly, which is this beta gamma assembly. Now, this assembly also detects the uranium, and the core is placed here, and all around this hole there are detectors in a circular fashion, and they detect the possibility of grade with the help of beta gamma radiations. So this is another confirmation for the presence of uranium. Now, next is this core. Its lithology also is established. And this core is particularly from Meghalaya, where it is associated with a carbonaceous matter. Now, this carbonaceous matter being a reducing agent, the uranium which has come in the solution got reduced, and this is the particular portion of the core which is showing better grade uranium concentration. Now, this uranium presence is also confirmed in the laboratory. This is the petrological section and the thin section of the same core, and we can see how the coffeinite is present here in this petrographic slide. So from all the methods, we confirm the presence of uranium, that is by gamma ray logging, by beta gamma logging, and also the petrological examination. Other than this, we also do chemistry test. Petrological laboratories, we confirm the presence. In the chemistry lab, the technique of AAS, atomic absorption spectrometry, or electron microprobe, or other instruments. I will give you more advanced instruments. So these are very conventional instruments in the chemistry lab, which confirm the presence of uranium. Now, some of the modern techniques, as I have already enumerated, this is the airborne time domain TDM magnetometry, or triple electromagnetic survey, airborne gravity gradiometric survey, hyperspectral. These are various techniques now being used for uranium exploration. And in the laboratories, we are also using TIMS or ICP-MS or spectrography techniques, GF-AAS or QAMSAN, and electron microscopy. These are also used for other minerals, but also for uranium. So these are the techniques from which we gather the information about the presence of uranium, its grade, and then by drilling, we also know its shape and size and the volume. As far as uranium exploration in the world is concerned, these are the various types. As I told you, that in unconformity type in the world, about 12% uranium is available, though it is very high grade, but only found in Canada and Australia. Then we have metasomatic types, volcanic types, intrusive types, vein types, and this is that oldest QPC type, which gives about 3% contribution of the entire resources of uranium in the world. Then this is one unique type, which is also found in the Australia, Olympic Dam, iron ore breccia complex. So because this is a single deposit and very large in size, so its contribution is high, very high, 20%. So this is in general the distribution of uranium deposits in the world. So thank you very much. That's it.
Thank you, Pramodji, for such a wonderful presentation. This is so essentially what you are telling me, that most of the deposits that we find are the uranium that is mobilized, the insoluble uranium 4 that is mobilized by groundwater or other fluid movement within the
Exactly. And then oxidation process.
In oxidized fluids, and then it migrates to it keeps migrating till the oxidation condition gets to reducing condition, and then it just gets deposited. So one good, very good thing, is to find the location of where the redox front exists, and that would be a potential deposit location.
Absolutely, yes. That's right.
Thank you, Pramodji, for such an excellent talk.
Thank you for watching the video. I invite you all to please visit the Mineral Exploration Academy website and register yourself. The registration is free, and registration is open to students, teachers, professionals, or anybody who is interested in mineral exploration. The registration will also provide you an access to be able to ask questions from our experts, and also provide an opportunity for established experts to answer and interact with the students. The registration form is available on the Mineral Exploration Academy website. I would also encourage you to look at the editorials and opinion sections, and visit the student question and answer section at the bottom here. In the student question and answer section, the questions asked by the students are being answered by our experts. Our experts are the top people in the field, and it would be a wonderful learning opportunity for the students, for probably the questions that occurred to you but you could not ask, or to review questions what have occurred to other people and get the answers the different experts are providing. Thank you so much, and I look forward to interacting with you a lot more.